So, and as always, you are muted, but that does not mean you cannot ask any questions. We have a Q&A session running at the right side of your screen. Depending on your language settings, it might be called a little bit differently, but you can ask there all your questions you have about the subject or even beyond, if there's any questions popping up in your mind. So please feel free to do that. And you also can, of course, drop us a direct mail question if that's more convenient for you. If we have time available, we will answer your questions at the end of the session. We have reserved about 10, 15 minutes for that. If it's too complicated to answer directly or we have run out of time, then of course we come back to you on a later point by a video call or an email or what's best in that respect. As said, we are recording this session. This will be posted on our YouTube channel, which you can later on view back. And of course, you can always forward it always to coworkers or some other people you might think that is interesting for. So that is the introduction. I will start off the presentation and then I will hand over to Pascal. I will try to do it in about 30 minutes. Hopefully that will go all right. So let's see. This is my small agenda for today. Just do a small introduction of USB, then talk about power delivery, filtering that comes along with it. And we're also going to talk about high-speed data and wireless communication that is important in this respect as well. So a lot of different subjects in this topic, and I will try to squeeze it all in 30 minutes. So wish me luck. So looking at USB, of course, you have a lot of different versions already in front of it. This was already spoken about in the last session, so I won't repeat that. I'll just dive into the 3.x standard. And if you look to a very top level view, we can basically say we have two sides. We have the side that will transmit data, but also just the power delivery, subject of today. And then we have the receptacle side, which will receive the data and also the power. In order to do that, of course, we need a lot of different building blocks. And from a top level, we can identify on the left where we have two PCB boards, which are two of our own reference designs we made together with ST, which are the power sourcing equipment tools. We have on the left board, the blue one is a 40 watt board, and the green one can deliver up to 100 watt of power. And of course, this power needs to be converted for something. Then you see a DC jack on both of the boards, and you could inject your power with a standard industrial controller running at 24 volt or 48 volts, but it could also be something different, and then you need to convert down to the voltage you need, and that's what you need is really determined by the receptacle side, which is really programming, saying, okay, I will need 15 watts, and I would like to have that within voltage of 15 volt or 20 volt or whatever settings is put in there, and then both systems talk together. But that's the subject that that Pascal will be handling a bit more. And then in the end, hopefully, then the power delivery will start and you can power up your device with the required voltage and power levels, current levels. So this is what we are doing here. I could talk a lot about this DC-DC converter over here, but to be honest, if we go into in this subject, especially if we go to the higher power ones, 100 for the current standard, but for the upcoming standard, even goes to 240 watts. And then there's a lot to talk about how to create a proper DC-DC converter with all the layout and stuff. So this is a subject on its own. For now, for this topic, I will just mainly look at my part of the power delivery, which is also important. So looking at the typical USB 3 signal flow, and then we talk about the C connector because this one, of course, is designed especially for the higher powers as well. We have a plug, we have a PCB, or in our case, we have two plugs, but that's just because it's an evaluation board. And in between those two plugs, there we have different blocks. We have the backwards compatibility for USB 2.0. We have the USB 3.x signal lines, and we have a power block on the bottom. And all three are protected for ESD over voltage situations, and the both signal lines are equipped with some kind of commode filtering, which is needed to make everything work as it should. So this next slide you already saw as well, so I'm not going to dive very, very deep in here. It's just to give you a little bit of an overview what's on the boards and what's important. So we see in this case, we see 2x the connector, but of course in your application, typically you would only see 1x the connector. Running from top to bottom, and we see the common modes here, the TVS diodes for the different data paths. And of course, on the bottom here, we see the EMI filter for the power lines, which is important to create correctly. So not going into all the part numbers and much details there, just the brief overview. So if we go into the signal paths and we are looking at the differential signaling, what's going on, we can ask our question, of course, why don't we use the single end transmission paths? This is something we could do, of course, as well. But differential mode, of course, has a lot of benefits. First of all, we have the out of phase transient go on. So we have the plus and the minus, which is, of course, the current is running in opposite direction. So we have a lot of cancellation there already of the noise. And also, if there's any noise coupled onto the paths, it will be coupled on both of the paths, and it will be helping to reduce that amplitude there as well. Furthermore, we have possibility to run on lower voltages. So this will help us a lot, especially if you also want to run high data speeds, because if you have a high data speed, of course, you have always to consider the rise times and the fall times, and it's just a lot quicker to go to 0 to 1 volt instead of going from 0 to 12 volts. That just takes a lot more time, and so there's a lot of good reasons for going for differential mode signaling. And this all has to run over the PCB and also over the cable, of course, but I will focus on the PCB for this part. And you probably all recognize this as a nice PCB with the green material, which is typically FR4 material with an epsilon R just around 4. But of course, there can be different materials here. And your signal itself will be running on the microstrip, which needs to be impedance matched to whatever you're going to need for the specifications of the USB signal. And of course, the width of the track is mainly determined about the distances to the reference planes and everything around it, including the PCB materials. Furthermore, we have a return path for the currents, and that's typically just the ground plane that runs below it. And for this, it's always important to realize that if you're looking at the return path, that this behaves differently in DC compared to AC. If you're looking at the DC path, we see that we have a forward current moving over the microstrip, and the return path is basically the shortest route from A to B. So it does not make any incentive to follow the same path that the DC current is flowing. That will change if you go to an AC direction. If my slide goes, because the AC current will try to follow the lowest impedance path, and this lowest impedance path is just simply as close as possible to the forward current path, the microstrip in this case. So this is what we always see, and this is also what we want to see. Trouble could arise if we would create slots in the return path. And it could be because maybe you are creating two separate ground planes, but your microstrip is passing over those two ground planes. Then the AC current is not allowed. It's not able to follow exactly the same path, and it has to make a detour. And this, of course, will have an effect on signal integrity and also on your radiated emissions, which might not be something you would like. So if you need to make a slot in your ground plane, make sure that your microstrip is not running over that slot. And if it is running over that slot, make sure that's a connection below it, so that the path is at least as short as possible that it can follow. always imported. And also, if we're going to look at the vias, my colleague Remco talked a little bit about this last session already, so I'm not going into too much detail here. But also, if you use vias on the board, then you have to be careful to make sure that the clearances between the reference planes and the via itself remains intact. Because if you use a via, for sure you're going to impact impedance values, and this will impact signal integrity quite a lot. And also, if you use a via, make sure that the return pot also has a via very close to it, so that the return current can flow very close to the signal itself, which is always important to do. So then we have to consider common mode noise. In the ideal world, of course, we wouldn't have any issues here, because we have, of course, the differentials. Differential path who will cancel everything out, and if that's not what's going to happen, there should be enough common mode rejection in the system. But in reality, of course, it's not going to happen, because there's always impedance mismatches because of just slightly wider or smaller traces, and maybe there's a little bit length difference, or the voltage levels are not completely the same. There's always some mismatch, and this will always push to some common mode noise. So we have to consider that while designing high speed data systems, in order not to create interference that will interrupt other equipment that is outside your control, but that could also interrupt your own internal communications and systems as well, of course. So we have to be careful there. So in order to do that, you can use a lot of components to start your filtering. Most of them already saw, so I'm not going into much details here, just to emphasize that they are there, and some typical partners that are used here. So on the top we see the common mode shocks. Depending if you use USB 2.0 or 3.0, and then depending on the speed, you will need to make some different choices there, because you have a lot higher data rates, so also a lot higher frequencies, and you need to make sure that your insertion loss on your differential signal is as low as possible. And also we have, if we are also having from RF communication on the board, then we could see some interference coming from that RF from the USB system that would interfere with Wi-Fi or Bluetooth or some other proprietary interface. So for that reason, we have also a narrowband common mode choke that could be very interesting. We need some ESD protection, and that's just about what I'm going to say about it. It's there, and you need to make sure that the capacitance is as low as possible to meet your signal speed. And we need to have some filtering on the power lines, for which we're using tidbit ferrites, we're using capacitors, and we're using power inductors. But later on, more on that topic. So, what is the issue? And this is both true for the common mode noise that we're going to talk about now, but also later on for the power. If we're using high-speed data like USB 3 running at 5 gigabit or maybe even 10, we are going to create a lot of frequencies in a very broad spectrum, meaning basically from running from DC up to about 5 gigahertz for the Gen 1. And nicely in between on this graph, you see the 2.5 gigahertz, which of course is used for wireless communications a lot, because that is a free band we can use in the ISM bands for Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, and a lot of other interfaces. And this will pose an issue, and you even need to test for this at this point. And what's going on, what could be going on, at least if you would see the data spectrum of a measurement near the connector, you would see that you would have a lot of noise ranging up to about 5 gigahertz. And well, again, in that 2.5 gigahertz range, you will see that you have a lot more noise than you would have in the higher frequency here, where the noise is gone. So basically, this is the noise floor. And this would impact your performance of your wireless system quite a lot. It could diminish its performance, or it could prevent a connection at all, depending, of course, on the total system, how it was built up, and what your requirements are. So this is important to take a look at. And in a block diagram here, you could draw it like this for a lot of different applications, IoT devices, but also notebooks, industrial tablets, or whatever. You would see a lot of interfacing going on, from sides, from cables, USB Type-C, HDMI, but another high-speed interfaces, if you're using FPGAs with high-speed services on that, then you could also have the same issue. And on the other side, we see that there is a wireless system close by. And at the same time, we see that these are getting closer and closer to each other, because most applications need to be smaller and smaller and smaller. And this poses an issue. Those high-speed signaling will start interfering with wireless communication, which is important to know. And basically what's going to happen is that we have a noise floor, and it will be just being moved up so that your Wi-Fi signal is buried within that noise floor and cannot get out and cannot be received by the other side. So in order to solve this, you can use called mode chokes. We see two types here. The one on the right is our CNSW, which is our, well, let's call it a classic combo choke. It's wire wound, something we're using for many, many years already. This is available in two flavors, a normal one and a high frequency one. And if you look at the solid lines, you can clearly see the difference. The black line and the red line over here on top, they are clearly different. And what is very good to see is that the -3 dB points for the red one, so for the normal one, is already at, let's say, almost 2 gigahertz, while the high frequency will move up to about 7.5-8 gigahertz, meaning that your signal will be much more unaffected using the high frequency one. But the price you pay is less called mode impedance. If you look at the dotted lines, you can clearly see that at the 2.5 gigahertz, the normal one will give you about 22-ish dB insertion loss, while the high frequency will give you about 15. To give you a bit more punch there, we have developed this ceramic one. This is a comm mode choke, but not in the classical sense. There's no buffalo wires go around it. Basically, there's a notch filter inside, a fifth order filter, which is specifically tuned for specific frequencies. So in this example, it's tuned for the 2.45 gigahertz, and it will give you this peak impedance at that specific frequency of about, let's say, 48, 47 decibels at that specific frequency, just to clean up the high frequency noises you might experience. We have also versions that are tuned for the 5.5 gigahertz, and also versions who can do both of them. So that is just interesting. So this is important to realize. And just to give you a brief introduction of what this could mean for you, and I won't go through all of them, but basically in the picture on the left, on in red, you can see we can do only 60 megabits. If there's a lot of noise on the channel, this will drop to almost 4. And if you clean up that using this ceramic combo choke, you can clean it up and get about 14 megabits again. So there's a lot of improvement going on there. And this is just from acceptable to very good, but you can also go from non-acceptable to acceptable, depending, of course, on the system. So moving to power, power is interesting because if you look at the bottom of our reference board, you see a big filter. And when you look back to the USB 2.0 filters, you could just place a chip-bit ferrite in the power lines and you would be okay. And if you want it a little bit more, you make it an LC filter or even a PI filter, and then you have a very, very good filter already. But for USB 3, we cannot do that easily, because the frequency band of the noise is much, much wider. So we need to make our filter as wide as possible as well. So what have we done here? We have introduced three inductors. Two of them are chip-bit ferrites, and so that's our L6 and L8. And L7 is a normal wire-wound inductor. C1 and C2 are just ceramic capacitors, and D6 is used for protection against ESD up to the 20 volt input voltage that is available in the standard. So, and if you want to design a filter like this, we need to take a few things in consideration. First of all, we are needed to make sure where the cutoff frequency will start. So typically we'll start about 1/10 of the data rate in this case. This is a nice point to start. And we also need to take care in account that components will change their behavior well under load. Chip bit ferrites suffer DC bias behavior. MLC capacitors will suffer for DC bias behavior. And even wire-wound inductors will start saturating. So they also will have some behaviors that we need to take into account. So we need to make sure that we design the filter for the right application. And because, of course, USB is giving you the option to provide, well, no power up to 100 watts and everything in between, and soon even up to 240 watts, you need to make sure that your filter's up to the task for that specific application you are going to design. Otherwise, it might be not sufficient. So if we look to chip bit, for instance, we have here the L6 and L8, which are specified as an 110 ohm chip bit ferrite. This means that it will provide 110 ohm impedance at 100 megahertz, and they are packaged in a 1206 size. And this value is measured at 0 amps, which is quite nice because then we can write high values. But in reality, you get a lot less. And that's just because in this material, there's no air gap. And we only have a nickel zinc material, which has a very narrow BH curve. And this will start saturating for that reason pretty quickly. And if you would put three amps to it, yeah, you would get the second blue line at just about, well, let's say 12, 13 ohms of impedance, so a lot less already. And if you would increase to 5 amps, then it will drop even further. So this is something you have to take into account when you select components, if this is enough for your application or not. Of course, for the higher frequencies, we see we still get a lot of attenuation. The impedance will ramp up there. And this is the most important part for this particular application. So this is important to see. Also, we have to take care of currents. In general, if you look at multilayer components, they are not suited for inverse currents, meaning that the rated current, which is specified in the datasheet, in this case 5.4 amps, is also the maximum current, also for 1 nanosecond or 1 millisecond or 1 second. This is the limitation. The exception on that rule is the MPSB series, which we are using here. They can endure higher currents for a short period of time. I'm not going into too much details, but just to give you an indication, if you would use an 8 millisecond pulse, we could have a 30 amp inverse current to that inductor, and that will survive for about 2500-2600 times if you do this. Of course, when the pulse is shorter, it will survive longer. If the current is lower, it will survive longer. So you need to tune this for your application and for your expectations. But just to give you an indication that this is possible, but you need to make sure you select the right components. Now, furthermore, we have to look at the power inductor, which is in this case one of our MAPI series. 3020 is the size code, meaning it's 3 by 3 millimeters and 2 millimeters high, so it's pretty small, and it's 1.2 microhenries. And if we would run 3 amps to it, it will start saturating just below 1.1 microhenries, which is still okay. If I would just use the same inductor for 5 amps, then it would saturate well below 1 microhenry, so that might not be okay anymore. Same goes for self-heating, because of course when we run a current to this inductor, it will have a resistance and the current. If you do the current in the squared and then times the resistance, you have the power loss in the winding, which is all the losses in the inductor at this point. And this will give a self-heating of about 20 degrees Celsius for the 3 amp situation. And that's fine if we assume 30 degrees on the board, the inductor will be about 50 degrees Celsius, which is well within specification. If we would run 5 amp for the same inductor, I have to extend the line. And then we see that we go well above 70 degrees. Well, plus that same 30 degrees will run us above 100 degrees. For the inductor, it's still okay. Not sure you want it. It's quite a hot inductor, so I would not recommend that. So we might need to up that. And that is also the case. The filter we're seeing here is designed for 60 watts and not for 100 watts. do that later on. And last but not least, we need to make sure that our capacitors are up to the job. We took here an 0805 capacitor, 4.7 microfarads at 25 volts rated voltage. This means that at 0 volt, it will have the 4.7 microfarads. If we would apply 5 volts, we would have about 3.5. If we apply 15 volts, we will drop to about 1.2-ish. And if we go to the 20 volt, we are dropping below 1 microfarad. This, of course, will have an effect on the filter as well. So we need to make sure that it will be up to the job in the circumstances that we are going to use it. If you want to minimize this effect, the best thing to do, the easy thing to do, is to make the capacitor bigger. Won't be always the things you want to hear because you don't have the space on the board. But the bigger the capacitor is, the less this DC bias behavior will affect it. So then if we're going to look at the filter, we have here on the left side, the left graph is the 100 watt. On the right side, it's the 60 watt. And that represents the red line. And you can see the filter characteristics is quite similar. The 100 watt is performing slightly better, especially between the few megahertz up to the few tens of megahertz, which is mainly due because there's less saturation because we use bigger components. For this filter, we recommend an 1812 instead of a 1206 for the chip beat ferrite. And we increase the inductor for 4020 to for 3020 to 4020. But the values are basically the same, but we up the specs a little bit to make sure. And this has an effect if you look at the DC bias behavior of the chip beat ferrite. Again, at 100 megahertz, you can clearly see the blue line is the 1206, which is just below 10 ohms. And the yellow line is the bigger part. And we see that we have quite a lot more impedance there also for the lower frequencies, which will help filtering there, of course, a little bit better. And same goes for the inductor. If we compare the two conductors, both 1.2 microhenries, we can see that under load, 5 amp load or 3 amp load, this is the inductance that is present. The bigger component will just have more inductance, so it will be a little bit more effective there as well. And also important is to note the temperature difference. If we would only allow 3 amps and still use the big component, it will have a temperature rise of about 9 degrees. If you go to 5 amps, it will have a temperature rise of about 21 degrees. And at 5 amps, we see that this is 28, let's say 29. And the 3020 is not filled in because I had to extend the graph, so it's not in the tool. It's we never did the measurement, but it will be well beyond 70 degrees Celsius. So there's a lot of things there that needs to take into account. So if you're going to design your filter, a great tool to use is a simulation. For instance, LTSPICE, which is a free tool, but you can also use other SPICE simulators. We have models for both LTSPICE and PSPICE, which are fully modeled libraries, which will help you very much in designing your EMI filter already in simulation. So this will make your design process go a little bit faster in that respect. The only thing that is not fully modeled here is the DC bias behavior, of course, especially for the capacitors not in there yet, which you need to evaluate on the board. But you can use RedExpert and the graph to get a good indication of what kind of performance you will get there. So this one is the filter for the 100 watt design. So we use the bigger inductor, the bigger chip beat ferrites. As you can see, the graph is quite similar to what we have measured. We also have measured the temperature rise on the inductor, and you can clearly see that it does make a lot of difference how much current you will draw. From a temperature of 24 degrees, which is basically hardly any temperature rise because it's an increase above ambient, to about 65 degrees, which is quite a lot hotter. And this is, for the inductor, it's still good. There's nothing to worry about. But if you want your system to run a bit cooler, then you might want to have even a little bit bigger inductor there yet. But that, of course, is always up to you. What is important, and you can see that in the previous slide a little bit, is that we have different resistors, the RDC. It differs between the two types is about 50 milliohms. So the higher your RDC, of course, the more losses you will have. And of course, also the chip variants will have the loss. And they are in series, so we have to add them. And in total, we will have a voltage drop over the filter. Basically, yeah, it's the majority of that will come from the RDC, plus all the solder resistance, of course, on the board. And this will give you a power loss. And the yeah, depending on what you can accept there, you might want to have a lower RDC on the components or not, but that's in the end is up to you. But if you have 165 millivolts times 5 amps of current, well, that will give you something like a few hundred millivolts. So that's just, well, it could be quite significant if you are aiming for a very high efficiency system, of course. So this is what I wanted to show you. Oh, I did have this slide available to give you a little bit indication of temperatures on our test board. The measurements E1, E2 are the connector, where we have the highest temperature of around 60 degrees. And then the E3 is the power inductor itself, which is running about 70 degrees. The chip variants are not on here, but they run about 60 degrees in this example. So this is, you know, it's not cool, it's not cold, but it's also not overdone. But it really depends on the application of this is acceptable or not. But that's is something for another discussion. So that will bring me to this final slide. Just to give you a small overview of the typical application, if you look at USB, different components that can be used and different applications. But my time is pretty much up, so I won't spend too much time here, and I will just pass over to my colleague Pascal Berton so that he can start his presentation. I will give you presentation role. Here you go. So in the meantime, if you have any questions, don't hesitate to ask. Use the Q&A questions possibility on your right side of the screen. Pascal, good luck.
Thank you. Thank you, Alex. Is my presentation visible?
Yeah, it is, and you are also hearable.
All right. Thank you. So thank you, Alex. And thank you for following my presentation on power delivery. I will more focus on the USBF compliance and we'll go into the power delivery part. So for the agenda, I will recap a little bit on Type-C. Actually, there was a previous video. Show you some basics on power delivery, USBF compliance, and testing beyond USBF compliance. Who am I? So introduced me also last time. I'm Pascal Berthem and doing USB testing for 20 years nowadays. I joined a lot of workshops, certify already more than 1,000 products. Besides doing compliance, I also do debugging, developing some USB fixtures. But besides USB, I'm also doing other serial data stuff. And Eurofins, Eurofins is the first USB certification lab in the world and still the only one in EMEA region. Beside the USB certification, we do also pre-certification, all these kind of things. We have all the equipment in-house. We have a large pool of products to test against. We have flexible scheduling. Beside the USB testing, we also do other sort of testing. Now to the power delivery. Actually, so power delivery is only over Type-C. I did give my previous presentation with Remco was with regards to Type-C. So if you want to have one more about Type-C, in order to understand actually power delivery, you have to understand a little bit about Type-C, because Type-C is the way to go for power delivery. So why is there power delivery? So there are all these different kind of charging mechanisms, like everybody had their own thing. Apple has them, Xiaomi, Huawei, Samsung. Then you got all these Qualcomm quick charge versions. So, and then the USBIF decided to make some kind of another standard that will all cover all these items in one standard. Now, that said, USBIF or the USB certification not allow any of the other certification at the same time. So you cannot have dash over Type-C and at the same time being USB-IF power delivery. So power delivery. So power delivery only works over Type-C, so not over Type-A connectors or the legacy connectors, as you know from before. So it only works over Type-C. What the communication goes over this CC line. So the source and sink talk to each other. So, and now we can go up to 100 watts. So before there was only 7.5 watts in the previous USB, but now we can go up to 100 watts. Power delivery is including also communication between the cables because 3 amp cables and 5 amp cables are not the same. So there need to be some discussion. The power is also not only like in the past going from the host or from the PC to the device. Now it also is possible from the device going to the host. So there's a more flexibility on the power direction. Now, as I said, there was in the previous slide, there was 100 watt, but only recently, like May 26th, it was announced by the USB-IF that they added the extended power range. So now you can go up to 240 watts. Now the current remains the same, but the voltage is now up to 48 volts in order to achieve the 240 watts. There are also some steps in between because yeah, you maybe not need 240, but other voltages. So they are fixed voltages, but there's also adjustable voltages for PPS. Beside the power delivery spec, also the Type-C spec changed because with the higher voltages, you have could have more problems with RSync. And for the Type-C spec, they changed from 2.0 to 2.1 now. So power delivery USB is not only data. I mean, you can also make a product that's only doing the charging, so like wall chargers or car, or there's no data anymore. We already see these kind of products like power tools having a Type-C connector, so there's a universal charger. They want to get rid of all these plugs, and with 240 watt, you may not cover everything yet, but there is of course a possibility to cover everything. Even though, yeah, I mean, even like European law and Chinese, they actually make it mandatory to use Type-C for future phones to do the charging. Now, what's power delivery? Here, an overview, a short overview that includes the whole spec of 1,000 pages. But power delivery is the specification is defined in several chapters. In order to achieve power delivery, you need to handle everything on Type-C. So there need to be a Type-C control. The physical layer covers the whole low-level part from the electrical part. There's a protocol layer. There's a power source. So the communication goes over Type-C from source to sink, and then the VBUS adjusts according to the whole policy and all the communication. So each part is defined in these chapters of the power delivery spec that is freely available, and you can download from the USB.org. It's an open standard. You don't need to pay for anything. PHY is a 300 kilobit per second BMC signal, and it's a 4 or 5 bit decoding scheme. There's also built-in, so BIST mode, so built-in self-test. This is for actually doing like eye diagrams for the signal integrity for the BMC signal. Protocol looks similar to many other standards like the regular USB. There's a CRC inside, there's a header, there's a start of a packet, an end of packet, and the type of packet is defined here in these data objects. There is one difference maybe that the SOP, depending on what's talking to who, because the cable can also have a chip inside, then they need to know which one is communicating to what. So you can talk from source to sink, but you can also talk from source to the cable, and then they differentiate these part of things. Here are the typical timings that you have to take care of. It's milliseconds range in seconds, so it's not that fast, but this is the negotiation times if you send something in the response time. A simple negotiation goes as follows. So the source, if you take out if there is no cable, with eMarkers, you will, the source will send out capabilities. So let's say the wall charger sends out capabilities. The phone, for example, that is connected, say, okay, you have these capabilities, let's say 9-volt, 2 amps, that looks good to me, so I request that. Then from that moment, the source will say, okay, I will accept that. And they said, PS ready, and okay, then the source will go to 9-volt and the sync will take that, the current cable. So the negotiation is pretty straightforward, I would say, for a power delivery negotiation. You also have to take into account the whole Type-C part. Sometimes a little bit confusing what is in the Type-C and what's in the power delivery spec, because the RP values and RD, that's something more defined in the Type-C. But yeah, these things you have to take into account. There are power delivery messages, many different ones, like wait, hold, and not accept. So there are, these are all defined in the specification. I'm not going into details in that part, because yeah, it's 1,000 pages and many different kind of messages are available. But what I do want to say is that an important part is like the PDO, the power delivery objects. So each source will say, okay, what capabilities he have, what kind of current he have, what kind of PDO he have. I mean, he need to say what capabilities he have, and then the sync can say, okay, I take this one. So that's PDO. There's also APDO, that's more, this comes from Power Delivery 3, so that's PPS. So then if the source have this capability, the sync can actually request all kind of voltages in between, and with small steps go, I mean, if he needs this kind of voltage, he will get this and he will request this each time. Now this makes it for mobile phone or small devices more convenient to use PPS, because they don't have to put too much effort in the DC-DC, because all the source will actually have the DC. They will have all the voltages inside, and inside the phone, you don't have to put the DC-DC in. So the CC lines are, I mean, there are many tools available. I prefer to use the Sigma 51 to take a trace, and then you can see the voltages. The communication is here is pretty straightforward, as mentioned before. He will send something and he will accept, and all these parameters are visible in these traces, and these tools are on the internet, of course, available. So let me jump to the USBF compliance. USBF compliance is based on the specification, of course, but the specification is not so straightforward. There are a lot of versions, but in order to meet the compliance, as I mentioned in my previous presentation, you need to pass many subsets, because this presentation will only cover the power delivery, but you also need to pass the Type-C part. You need to pass also your data supported, all the data testing and all these kind of things. But let us focus now on the power delivery. So the power delivery spec is the base spec. And then there is for compliance, there's a power delivery 2 section, and this power delivery 2 section is actually split up again to the deterministic and the communication engine. These specs are available on the USB doc, you can download them. And then there is a power delivery 3 part, and that covers a power delivery spec and a power delivery 3 merged version. And then for source testing, there's also another test specification. The merged is not yet, I mean, the merge is already in development, but it's not mandatory for compliance, and that's why it's in red here. Very important for the compliance testing is, I mean, in order to know what to test, we need to have a file. Also, the equipment we use we need to know the details of the product. Is it having these kind of all these the features that are supported need to be known in order to test. And that's why you need to fill out a FIF file. That FIF file is also, again, a free tool from the USB.org. You need to fill that out, and then you get an XML file eventually that will be used for later for the testing. So as mentioned before, so there's a power delivery 2 part for testing. All power the USB, so power delivery 2 and 3, need to test between a communication engine and to the deterministic engine. As I mentioned before, that PD2 is split up in two versions. Now, communication and deterministic MOI, they sometimes have the same test cases, but not always. And even if they're the same, they're not always correlate. So it's not always so straightforward. And depending on the features your product support, the power delivery to test spec covers around 50 test cases, depending on the features you have. Typically, measurements from PD2 are the eye diagram, as you see here, receiver interference rejection. So that's all PHY kind of testing real low level, but it's also testing the source capability, see if there's nothing wrong in there, good CRC, hard reset, and it verifies the voltages. If, let you say, you request 9 volt, if it's not 8 volt. So these kind of things are verified. In our lab for power delivery, we used for the communication engine, we used the Teledyne LaCroix MP310P, and for the deterministics, the ALICIS solution. There are also other solutions available, the GRL and MQP, but we don't use them in our lab. And for power delivery 3, so you need to test all the power delivery 2 part, and now the power delivery 3. Again, there's equipment available. We use, again, the ALICIS and LaCroix. There's, as I mentioned, there's a 3.0 compliance merge plan, but this one is not yet required for USBF compliance. This may change. I mean, they're working on a compliance plan to get it approved somewhere in time, but at this moment, it's not required to pass. Again, power delivery 3 has around 50 test cases. Again, really depending on the features you support. What it verifies, for example, it verifies if you're backwards compatible, their extended messages. Power delivery added a lot of more messages that were not available in use in power delivery 3. And then it also can verify PPS. Power delivery 3 did not have PPS, so this is also one of the test cases that is involved there. Now, for the sources and for DRPs, there's also the source testing. This was also in the previous presentation shown, because for things that for type C only products, it also need to be tested. So what it mainly do is verifying the VBUS under all kind of load conditions. It's an automated testing tool. So you plug in the source and with all the loads, with all ports connected. You don't see it good here on the picture, but it has 4 ports. And fully PD protocol aware. So it will request the PDOs. Once you know the PDOs, from that on, he know what kind of tests he need to run. It will also verify, so it will not only stress the port on the test, but also the adjacent port will be monitored during the whole test. There's also possibility to do some manual testing. Now for the power delivery source testing, what is done, the Quadramax will log every port and will keep logging the current and the voltage, and he will stimulate all the different protocols. So when he will say, okay, we are going to request 9 volt, and I see if that voltage remains within the values. In the meantime, I load the other ports and see if everything still is okay. Beside source testing, the Quadramax can also do cable testing. We don't do that too often in the lab, but there's also a possibility to do cable testing in with the Quadramax. The voltage drop that is significant with 5 amps in these cables is taken into account. The testing, the duration, and all these things depend really on how much your source supports. So what the Quadramax tests are covering is the load test, so really the load test, checking the capabilities, do hard reset tests, give back. Give back is only applicable for products with multiple ports. It will do overcurrent tests, actually see when the overcurrent works, the PPS voltage steps, and the PPS current limit. This is an example of how this Quadramax look like. So we had the compliance program. So not forget, you also had to do all the remaining tests, the type C and all the interoperability testing, but this will bring me too far in this presentation. But besides the compliance test, I would also say that do more testing. Compliance testing is done under ideal situations. I mean, the temperature is ambient. Then interoperability testing itself is only done at a few devices. Now we see, we do a lot of interoperability testing also in the lab. I mean, even two certified products, sometimes they not work together, but so I would say interoperability testing against a lot of products is very important. Safety is not really covered in the USBF compliance. Temperature, as I mentioned, performance also, the charging current or these kind of things are not covered in the, if your phone charges at 100 milliamp and it's still within the specification, yeah, then it still pass, but that's not covered. The cosmetic part and the user experiences is also not covered in the compliance. Of course, you cannot cover the whole specification. And beside that, yeah, you have to take into account that there are not many non-compliant products, or they have their vendor or vendor-specific charging mechanisms. So make sure that you test against these things as well. We in Eurofins have quite a lot of products and experience in doing this. Or as I mentioned, I mean, there are at this, of course, type C powder leaf is young, and there are still this early, so there are still many issues in the field. So make sure that you test aloft and not blow up any phones in the market. Or yeah, many very popular products are not even compliant, but yeah, you will have to make sure that your product works against these very popular parts. So make sure you test enough against many other products. That's it for my part.
Thank you very much. Very interesting. So we have a few questions already asked, so I'll come back to that later. First of all, I wanted to point out that we have a few other sessions planned together. So we have a session about wireless power that is available, that will be hosted June 24th, sorry. And we have our session about signal integrity for high-speed data, which is also very interesting. I put both of the registration links in the chat if you are interested. Sorry for the long link, but you can just press it and then it will work, hopefully. Let me see. Questions. Got a few. One of them is it possible to have USB PD with USB 2.0 data?
Yeah, that's no problem. I mean, many products like phones or laptops, you can do data, of course, as well.
Yeah, I can actually also give some examples where people don't even have any communication and just use power.
Yeah.
So you are free to do whatever you want in that respect without breaking any rules. So another question is, if we have a power level set, let's say 60 watt, 100 watt, doesn't really matter. Is that what we put in, or is that what we in the end get out of the controller at the device at the endpoint?
If you say 60 watt as a source, then the source should deliver 60 watt. If the sink takes that, I mean, typically they don't take that much, but yeah, that's what the source should deliver.
Okay, so I guess what
over the Type-C connector. Then,
yeah. I guess what's meant here is that compensated for any losses in the cable and in the EMI filter. But I don't think that's the case. I think you get whatever is delivered minus the losses.
Yeah. I mean, let's say 60 watt, then it should say 20 volt and 3 amps should be able to deliver them. That should go to the device then.
Okay, but of course you have a voltage drop over the cable, and that will probably lower the available power than at the end.
Yeah, there will be some losses.
Is that any, just a question from my side, that is in the specification how much voltage drop we can have over the cables.
That's defined, yeah. I don't know at the top of my head, but that's defined, yeah.
Okay. Sorry, popped in my own question. then another question, is there already compliance for power delivery for the extended power range?
It just came out, so they're working on the compliance program, and there is a working group in the USBIF that's working on that. So I expect it soon, but it's not yet available, and I don't think there's products anyway available at this part. But like the vendors, like LaCroix and all these vendors, they are of course working on this. But yeah, it will come soon.
Yeah, I can imagine. It will be a challenge, and either way, because if you're going to design this and you would use that full power, then of course your demand for your power supply would be quite steady as well. So it would be a nice and interesting design to do, I guess. But there's some challenges I had. Another question is popped in here. What are the frequency limitations? I'm not sure in what respect that is meant. Can you add more information, please? Yeah, that's the drawback of typing. That takes a while. Don't rush. No rush. Okay, let's see. We have another question that you can do in the meanwhile. So here's someone asking about the filter inductor. So that would be a question to me. And they ask if there was any benefit of using a different wire structure, like a flat wire. Yeah, of course, if you just look at the filter inductor purely to the resistance value, if you use a flat wire, typically you have a lower resistance and thus you have a lower voltage drop over that inductor for sure. That can be answered quite easily. And even then, it doesn't have to be that big. If we use one of our flat wire inductors, the smallest I think is 6 by 6 millimeters in that area, a little bit smaller even I think. So it's not that it will get huge directly, but there will be a clear benefit, of course, in respect to losses over the filter. So the question about frequency limitation not really added to that. Not sure what you mean by that. If you talk about frequency limitations of the system in general, yeah, of course every cable will have a limitation of what kind of frequency it can carry. Well, if there's still a question, just pop us an email, then we ask that later on. For now, I think all questions are answered. I will thank everyone for the attendance. Hope you enjoyed it, and I hope you will, will come back to our next sessions. There's one more questions, by the way, in my personal chat. If we can have a possibility to review this topics, yes, you can review them. They are on our YouTube channel. So if you're on YouTube, and you search for Root Electronic Group in English. Then you will come to our main page and then you can find them. And also we will send out a thank you mail with a link to the for this presentation, but then you can find the other one quite easily for sure. So that's one more question. So thank you again for everyone who's listening, and see you next time.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.